Thank you, Dr. Gupta. I might add, there is another aspect to technology, and it's called death by PowerPoint presentation. So thank you for being so patient with us and listening through to this. It's very interesting because most of we are, as we talk about terrorism and technology, the preponderance of what is immediately in front of us completely grabs our attention, and we sort of forget what has happened in the past. And as a result, what we are looking at is that, would you say that the 9/11 attacks did not use technology? Of course it did. The technology there was aircrafts, and that was used, and that was used very effectively and created a whole new narrative on terrorism. So while we all have a fair grasp of what the problem is, we are still grappling around with what the solutions are. So I've decided to try and build a presentation around what are the intuitive approaches that we can take on dealing with terrorism. But to understand that, I'll quickly take you through some of the uses that people are using terrorism for. The internet, for example, mostly for psychological warfare, a lot has been said throughout the day, publicity and propaganda, data mining, and this is something that we are seeing a lot emerging, where terrorists and terror groups are beginning to use digital repositories and see how they can use pieces of disparate databases and build up information which can then be deployed to carry out certain kinds of terror attacks. And this makes it very worrying because India seems to be going in exactly the opposite direction by creating a single database like Aadhaar and so on and so forth. Fundraising, of course, as the SP from NIA has mentioned and several other speakers. Networking amongst themselves, also within closed user groups, sharing information and planning and coordinating attacks. Also, when terrorists use a technology like the internet, and this is true about all kinds of communication technologies, you see that what are the real reasons behind which they're using and deploying those technologies? One is, of course, they need to keep their current and potential supporters happy. So therefore, constant communication is very, very important. And if you have read the interrogation report of David Coleman Headley, one of the key reasons that he gives in that interrogation report on why the Lashkar attacked Mumbai was that they were worried that their cadres will move on to the Taliban or the Al-Qaeda because there was more money and more action happening in that. And that's mentioned by David Coleman Headley as one key reason. So that's why communication is very, very important. Then also shape international public opinion. And that we've seen the ISIS doing it, but this is not new. I mean, people have done it centuries ago, and every organization would want to sort of use any technology available for more and more shaping of public opinion. And also, how do we shape the psychological warfare when it comes to nations that are considered inimical to you? So certain terror groups would have certain nations which they would consider as inimical, and how do we target the population of those countries? And this is where we are seeing new media and social media being deployed. Of course, the United Nations has come up with a report in 2012 which talks about how the internet, and this is exactly what Dr. Gupta just mentioned right now, when he said that the underlying technology, which is blockchain technology, it's very good. It basically uses a distributed ledger technology, which has very, very powerful uses and purposes which can be used for civilian applications. And Bitcoin was not meant to be something that can aid terrorists or those participating in illegal, etc. So therefore, there is this balance that we have to try and figure out. I just, to give you a understanding also of the context in India, how technology has been used so far, I'll just cite three specific cases. One is, of course, the this gentleman known as Yasin Bhatkal, who for many years has been associated with an organization called the Indian Mujahideen and several other organizations as well. And it's a very interesting story on how he was finally picked up. He was discovered in Nepal using traditional intelligence methods. And in fact, when the government of India and the Intelligence Bureau tried to reward the person who had first come up with the information, the person didn't even know that the information he had supplied leading to Yasin Bhatkal's arrest was actually such a big person. But if you look through his interrogation reports, you find that from a technology perspective, they're not using technology in a very, very sophisticated manner. It's a very, very basic kind of thing. We, of course, tend to think that it's very sophisticated because we are not familiar with the technology. And I'll get into that a little later when we discuss intuitive designs on how to counter all this. But what was Yasin doing basically? Most of the time he was using a fake email generator, emails which can, if you don't access them in 24 hours, all traces of them disappear immediately. He was using a lot of encrypted chat, and that's about it, and some secure communication methods. And there isn't much evidence, even in the interrogation reports, forget the trial records, which shows that he's using technology in a big way. And yet he was one of the most influential terror activists that we managed to catch. Let's look at what happened during the 26/11 attack. In sheer terms of technology, I thought the GPS and the use of VoIP was the most innovative parts of technology that the terrorists used, and yet they did it with such devastating sort of use. In the sense, for example, much of the GPS coordinates had already been picked up by David Coleman Headley, who on 7 occasions visited India, collected all the material on these targets. And this is all there also in his interrogation report, as well as some of Kasab's interrogation report, as well as David Coleman Headley, where he is talking about that this information was then passed on to the handlers in Lashkar-e-Toyba. And it's very interesting that here is a person coming in 6 or 7 times, is also traveling to Pakistan, and all that information is available at the Chicago Consulate of India, where they were picking this up, and yet nobody ever managed to put the dots together. And if we look at what the Indian Mujahideen, from what we know from charge sheets as well as interrogation reports, again fake emails, just like Yasin Bhatkal, secure chats, and also proxy IP addresses, and I think to an extent also a Tor browser, but that's about it. And yet they managed to hoodwink the whole system. When I was doing a little more research on what we call NGN or next generation security threats, the most interesting part that I have ever come across is a attack in 2008 on a pipeline in Turkey. And this is very interesting. This is probably the first time. I mean, everybody thought that this was a physical attack of terror, but some reports which came out at the end of 2014, and some of them are fairly credible, although I would like to caution you, even this has been disputed by some experts. What was discovered was that the pipeline had cameras, had physical security cameras going across. So hackers managed to, and these were all IP-based cameras, so they managed to hack into the IP addresses, using the IP addresses into the systems controlling the cameras. And these were also connected to the overall system at the back end, which was being used to increase or decrease pressure in the pipelines. And using, so therefore through a single act of hacking, they managed to get into that system and blew up the pipe. And those of you who are from the oil industry will know that crude cannot be set fire. So therefore, we still need to understand from more public documents how exactly this was carried out. But this is probably the only sophisticated use of technology in terrorism that I have personally come across till date. But what is happening is that the introduction of technology is therefore creating what has been commonly known in security parlance as next generation networks. And if you see the work of there's a book called Future Crimes by Mark Goodman, which has worked quite a bit of interesting and exciting work on this. Now, so let me try and frame some questions on that. While terrorists get away, why do establishments and governments fail to address this? Now, I'll just give you a story from India, because that's what I'm most familiar with. So why do terror groups innovate while security agencies lag behind? Let's look at the story of cybersecurity in our country. The IT Act of 2000 has no mention of cybersecurity. So as a state, we have not even understood. There is some elements of data privacy, because the European governments and other governments were trying to insist on India that because of your IT and ITES industry, you need to have some sort of data protection law. So there is some mention about how to protect data, but there is no concept of cybersecurity as a legal postulate in the act. And the first time it comes up is in 2008. And now here's a very interesting story. That in 2008, the IT Act is amended, and a whole new sections like 66A or 66F is brought in, and cybersecurity is recognized for the first time from a legal postulate But it also says that we will divide up the whole cybersecurity architecture in our country into two halves. One is critical and one is non-critical. And if you've noticed, Dr. Gulshanra, he's saying that today terror attacks are aiming at critical sectors. So this definition is made in law, and the law also says that an agency will be created specially to do this. That agency, mandated in 2008, comes up actually in January 2014. Now, the second query is that even if we had the best of technology at our disposal as security experts, how do we prioritize which technology to go for when we are designing a counter-terrorism response? And usually, people take the most counterintuitive approaches, and they forget that this is about data protection, they forget this is about privacy, and they always go for issues like mass surveillance. So in a way, in simple language, what we are doing is, if we are looking for that needle in the haystack, our approach is to increase more and more haystacks. So again, a few more questions. Like, one key thing, that there are a lot of studies on why the Americans failed to predict if you look at the American intelligence community, two issues come up as major points of failure, and a lot of studies have been written about it. One is of interest to us because of the 1998 May nuclear testing that we did. The American intelligence community took a lot of sort of soul searching to figure out why they failed to detect it, and a lot of literature is there available which looks at it. The other thing is, of course, the 9/11 attacks. And one interesting ways of how they have found ways to address this is that, how can we build internal capacities? And one interesting thing is, they created an internal wiki where all intelligence officials from different parts of the government, whether it is the FBI, the CIA, the NSA, etc., through your internal wiki, which is created, which is a database which has different layers and levels of access, you could put up a query and internally search for information, something that we haven't even really thought of in any of our intelligence organizations. So my question is that today, if I were to look at the first line of defense, which is basically the beat constable, what are the capacities and capabilities we are giving to that person on ground? Because that person on ground is supposed to be most aware of what is happening in that community. And our focus has never been on the beat constable. Then second, are our security agencies networked adequately to share data real time? Obviously, this is not happening, and I'll give you a personal example from that. Also, are CT professionals building credible counter narratives? Because a lot of information, like what Dr. Ann just showed you, a lot of information is about propaganda. Where are your counter narratives? And are city professionals working on this? Now, if I were to do a off-the-cuff survey of how many of our city professionals are on social media, the answer would be abysmal. And some of them I know personally, none of them have ever seen Twitter or Facebook. Now, are CT professionals also taking a multidisciplinary approach? Here you have a psychologist, a professional psychologist, talking about it. If you look at one of the most interesting studies done on the CIA, it's an ethnographic study done by Dr. Rob Johnston, where he's looking at the failures of terror of intelligence by doing an ethnographic study of what kind of relationships people had within the community and which led to a huge failure in 9/11. And none of us really take that multidisciplinary approach institutionally. And so while I was looking for answers, I came across this very interesting piece of work by General Stanley McChrystal, who was the JSOC commander in Iraq. And he went into some of these issues because in Iraq, he was in some ways seeing a kind of insurgency that our military has seen for decades in Jammu and Kashmir. And he was really figuring out that while we have the best technology and we have the best guys who are into hacking and who are into special forces and special operations, why are we still losing this war? And he figured out, and his conclusion was, that our efficient systems provided us with a solid foundation, but they could not bring us to victory. And if you turn your attention to the first horizontal thing, where he's talking about command and team, it's a very interesting concept that he's come up with, that today traditional hierarchies are trying to combat a war which has no hierarchy. So that is also leading to how information and strategy flows. And then he did a little more research and he figured out that some of these hierarchies that are available in government, in the military, or in the corporate world, all came out of a researcher who first presented it in a conference in Paris in 1900. So this is the level. So we are using 18th and 19th century or early 20th century models to fight wars of the future. And therefore, he then said that, which is why if you, when you look at commands, you have commands, and sometimes you have command of teams, but you never have a team of teams. So therefore, and this is what his understanding was, that big data will not be able to save us, because the technological advances that brought us these mountains of information have actually created volatile communication webs and media platforms, taking aspects of society that once resembled comets and turned them into cold fronts. We have moved from data poor but fairly predictable settings to data rich, uncertain ones. So basically what General McChrystal is trying to tell you is that unless and until you start shaping yourselves into commands which are interconnected and which uses multidisciplinary approaches and where the information flow from point A to point B is reduced significantly, you will never be able to track this. And I'll just quickly share one personal example. You might have heard of Ahmed Masroor Biswas, who was running the most influential ISIS Twitter handle out of Bangalore. And at 6 o'clock in the morning when I woke up, I suddenly woke up to this whole story about this happening. Channel 4 in the UK had broken the story. So around 6:45, I placed a call, one to somebody who's in the CT part of IB and one to somebody who was looking at CT in RNAW. And both of them were not aware about it because they had not seen the story. So they asked me individually that, can you help us find something? And I started Googling and I started looking at other social media networks to try and find information. And real time, whatever I found, including from the cache memory, the photograph of that person and so on and so forth, I passed it on to them on email. At 4 o'clock, I get a call from the IB. At 3 o'clock, which I couldn't take, after an hour, I returned the call and they were asking that, we are sitting with our technology teams and we are finding the same results that you gave us in the morning. How did you find it? Because that will help us validate this. So I then pointed out that these are very simple ways and tools that you can find out this information. And they were convinced that this boy is from Infosys. And I said, no, he belongs to a food company, but I have not been able to figure out which food company this is. Ultimately, it turned out to be with Britannia Industries, and that's how we found the information. So the idea is that unless and until you don't look at intuitive designs, you will never be able to sort of crack this. And this I found, which this former Iraqi chief minister had mentioned this, that the battle against terrorism is not only a military fight, but primarily a battle of information. And therefore, unless we figure out what are the end points and end results of the use of technology, we'll never be able to tackle it in as many ways. And my paper is available and we'll be working on this a little more. So please feel free to get back to me on this. Thank you.